Star Walker Studios presents Game Master's Journey, your multidimensional RPG podcast. Hello, fellow gamer. Welcome to episode 148 of Game Master's Journey, your multidimensional RPG podcast. I'm Lex Starwalker. On this show, we discuss the craft and art of game mastering. Not only do I pass along any knowledge I've gained over 25 plus years of running RPGs, I also share wisdom from guest GMs and listener GMs like you. Stephen Rhodes joins me on the show today to talk about how being a game master helped him get where he is today as a writer for Ubisoft Games. We also discuss writing and publishing RPG adventures, the pros and cons of class-based games, and our thoughts on the ultimate RPG super system. Finally, Stephen gives some insights on starting a new campaign, and we explore techniques for running RPGs for new and veteran players. So that is a lot that we are going to cover today. I'm really excited to get Stephen on here, but first, I have a couple announcements to make. First of all, I want to give a shout out and a thank you to brand new patron of Starwalker Studios, RJ Liljestrom. I hope I got that last name right, or at least close. Thank you very much, RJ, for joining the esteemed ranks of the patrons of Starwalker Studios. I really appreciate it. Without the patrons, this show would not be possible and would not be a thing in your ear holes right now. So thank you very much, RJ, and thank you to all the patrons. Also want to remind you that my D&D adventure, The Trickster's Labyrinth, will be released soon. I've teased the cover art for it. My wife, Nikki, did the cover art, and it's gorgeous. Definitely go check it out. I'll have a link in the show notes at starwalkerstudios.com. And that link will take you to a page where you can see the cover art. And that page that it takes you to will also be where you can buy the adventure once it's up for sale. So it will be up for sale on my website. It is going to be PDF only, at least for now. Nikki and I have discussed doing a print-on-demand version, but we're not doing that right now. Maybe someday in the future. Those of you that have been with the show for a while know that I was going to kickstart this adventure, and I just don't have the time to run a Kickstarter right now, and I didn't want to make everybody wait on it. So I'm just going to put it out, but I do have a lot of ideas on how to expand the adventure. And so maybe in the future, I might do a Kickstarter for this and other adventures I'm working on. And if or when that happens, I think print-on-demand versions of the various adventures would at the very least be a possible stretch goal for that Kickstarter, if not something that was part of it from the beginning. But I do have other adventures I want to write. Specifically, I have some Primordia adventures I want to develop and write. So once I get some of those done, you know, maybe I'll do some kind of Kickstarter to revise all the adventures and put them together into some kind of hard copy format. But for right now, the Trickster's Labyrinth is just going to be PDF. And I mean, if I do a Kickstarter, it's not going to be anytime soon. So, you know, if you're thinking, oh, I'll just wait for the Kickstarter, I wouldn't recommend that. It could be a year, it could be years, it could be never. But it definitely won't be anytime soon, because I got a lot going on over here at Starwalker Studios. And I have some other things going on that has nothing to do with Starwalker Studios, including a new job. So I am just crazy busy right now. The adventure is finished. The art's done, and it's over halfway done being laid out. So I think it should be on the website very soon, probably within a week or two, hopefully. So I'm really excited for everybody to see it and let me know what you think of it. So it's an adventure for third-level characters using 5th edition D&D. It can be used to springboard a brand new campaign, and I give guidelines for making new third level characters. It can easily be plopped into a campaign you're already running. It can be used no matter what setting you use for your game, whether it's an official published setting like the Forgotten Realms or your own homebrew setting. It's going to be super easy to use this adventure no matter where you run your game. And I give advice on how to do that, how to get into the adventure, and even some thoughts on how to return to the adventure later and kind of what to do after you've finished the adventure with your group. So really user-friendly adventure, I think. I think third level is a great place to start a new campaign. I think unless your players are brand new to fifth edition, I think they will thank you for starting at third level. And I think you will thank yourself for starting at third level. I've talked before on the show about how I think third level is the sweet spot to start a D&D campaign, unless you have brand new characters that really need to kind of take baby steps into the game. But otherwise, I think third level is where you want to be. But for those GMs that like to start at first level, you know, you've got a couple two levels. You can do your own thing, and then you can do the Trickster's Labyrinth. So there you go. I hope people like it, and definitely go check out the art. It's super cool. Stephen Rhodes is joining me on the show today, and Stephen is a multifaceted, multi-talented individual who's been running RPGs for a long time, and as far as his professional career life, he is a writer for Ubisoft Games right now, and he's written on quite a few video games, and some titles that he's written on that you might recognize include some of the Lego games and also The Witcher 3, which I was super excited when I found out he wrote for The Witcher 3 because I played the crap out of The Witcher 3. Love that game. That's one of my favorite games on the PS4. And so cool that he wrote on that. Steven, I meant to ask you like what specifically you wrote, what quests or whatever, just for my own morbid curiosity. So Steven has quite a few feathers in his cap. He's also a writer on the Seven game, which is an indie game, and he's a writer on the Open Legend RPG. So I'll have some links in the show notes over at starwalkerstudios.com for this episode, episode 148, to Steven's various projects and where you can find him out there in the digital lands. So definitely go check that out. So without further ado, here's Steven. Tell us where in the world you're from.
I'm from a town called Blackpool in the northwest of England in the United Kingdom. That's where I was born and where I grew up. So that's the little corner of the world that I'm from.
And where are you now? Because you're not there now, right?
No. I'm in.
You've moved on.
I'm in. I've moved all over the place. Right now, as of this, I am in Quebec City in Canada.
Oh, awesome! Very cool.
Yeah, so I've been flung quite far afield.
I always love talking to non-Americans, so take that as you will, but...
Yeah, why?
Well, it started really, I guess, I used to play quite a bit of EVE Online, and so I met people from all over the world in that game, and I just thought it was so cool to talk to people from England or Australia or Germany or wherever, and then... doing the podcast, I've also talked to people from all over the world, and I've played RPGs with people from the UK and Australia and Canada, and it's just super cool to meet people from other places.
Yeah, no, I love it. It's one of the very cool things about being someone who works and like lives in other countries. It's you get to experience other cultures and meet loads of different people, and I really like it. It's a good aspect of it.
Yeah, I haven't lived in another country. That would be cool, though.
Yeah, it's...
Especially now. Yeah. Canada sounds really nice right now.
Yeah, Canada's not far, right? So it's pretty good up there so far. Like, yeah.
I'm actually 20 minutes from the border.
No way.
But I'm on the other side of Canada. I'm in Bellingham, Washington. So I'm pretty close to Vancouver. So
yeah. I don't need to get over. It's very strange for me coming from England how just ridiculously massive this country is.
Yes, yes.
And it's like I talk to people who are in Canada, who are like my friends, but they're in a different time zone, and that like that blows my mind. Like, you know, because it's so huge, it's crazy.
Yeah, and Canada has a lot of kind of untamed wilderness too, like up north, which is pretty cool.
I feel like we're like the roof of the world up in Quebec. Like, I don't feel like there's very much above us except polar bears.
Yeah, you got to be careful of those polar bears, man. Mm. They'll mess you up.
Yeah, I see them walking around and in packs and wandering down the street looking for unsuspecting British people to eat.
So how about RPGs? How'd you get into the RPG hobby?
So RPGs, I discovered it when I was probably like 13, 14, something like that. I'd been going to like the local games workshop for a few years, playing war games and stuff and making friends in that environment. And then those friends sort of introduced me to the element of role playing because I was big into storytelling, obviously, but like, you know, it's my profession now. So it's like, I've always been interested in that side of things. So we started mucking around in role playing and doing that sort of on the odd evening or weekends. And then as soon as I got introduced to that, it just sort of ignited the spark in me. And I was like, then I became sort of, I did a lot of the GMing for us and I wrote the campaigns and, I bought the books and dabbled in the different systems and said, oh, you know, let's try this system or let's play this game. Let me run this. And that kind of just, it never left then. It was just this thing I've always done. I mean, it took, you know, there were periods where I didn't do it as much, like where I was, when I went to university, I still did it there. Like I still found a group and I still did it, but it wasn't quite as prevalent. And then when I started my career, obviously I didn't have as much free time. And so like some certain hobbies took a back seat. But then once I'd settled into my career and I was feeling like I had more spare time and I didn't have to sort of throw everything I had into my job, I started doing the role play again and picked it back up. And actually, it's funny, I attribute my role play work to be one of the more, like, one of the sort of key factors to how I've got places in my life. Like when I went for my interview for my university course, I took my Star Wars campaign that I'd written for my friends in this big A4 folder. And like the lecturer loved it. Like the course leader was really impressed by it.
Oh, cool.
And then when I went for my job interview at CD Projekt Red, one of the things they really wanted to know about was my RPG background and the campaigns I'd done and talked about that. Like they talked about that a lot more than we actually talked about my work in the video game industry.
Wow.
So I feel like my sort of story-based sort of nerdy hobby of role-playing has kind of really helped me get to the places I've been in my life and my career.
That's awesome. I did an episode a while ago about a TED talk I saw about how playing RPGs is good for you really cool. I didn't even think about like the professional side of it and how it could take you places.
Yeah, that talk was really good. I watched it and I agreed with everything that he had to say about it. I was like, it's so true. Like the skills you develop doing it and it accesses just a different part of your brain, I think, and it's interaction, social interaction in such a unique way that it's very hard to find it elsewhere. You know, people attribute it to like acting and people attribute it to like team building, but it's such a blend of all those different things and it really creates a unique experience. And I think from a DM side as well, like writing, you know, I write film scripts and I write short stories, novels, and like obviously video games, but like writing a campaign for an RPG is a completely different beast to all of those things. It shares some similarities with like structure and like themes, but it's just different because you know that it's going to be played by, it's going to be interpreted by a group of people. And they can just do anything and they can just go off in different directions that you are completely powerless to predict.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. Yeah. I could see running games, especially kind of helping you if you ever had to do any kind of public speaking, because you have to think on your feet and you have people staring at you, which, you know, just having four or five people staring at you is something to get used to. for a lot of us.
it's terrifying. Even now, like I still get a little bit of anxiety even now when I sit down with a group of players and start a campaign. Like there's always those butterflies that are there, just like, oh, is this going to go well? And are they going to like how I do things? So it's, definitely. I look back at all the hours I spent reading RPG source books and writing campaigns when I should have been studying chemistry and biology and stuff. And I literally regret none of it at this point because it's like, it's helped me so much in the future. Like if I could go back in time and and tell myself, oh, if you want to like get to be like a games writer, do this and that, I'd just say, just keep doing that because that will help the most.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, I just finished writing an adventure that I'm going to publish. And that was a learning experience, you know, that compared to just coming up with something for my players. Cause you said how, like, compared to other forms of writing, it's a lot different in a lot of ways because, you know, you don't know what the players are going to do. And as soon as you start going beyond your own personal group of players, it's even more like that because, you know, you might have some idea of what your particular players are going to do, but if you're making something for everybody, like, you really don't know what people might do. And you have to sit and think, okay, what are all the possible things people might do here and try to come up with contingencies, but you're never going to come up with everything.
No, I think when you're writing your own like campaign that's going to be published, you just got to like, you've almost got to like disregard all of that and not worry about it and just focus on your vision for the content and then let people interpret it and add bits where they need to.
Yeah. I feel like sometimes GMs will criticize published things because they'll be like, well, my players did this and the adventure didn't have any guidance on what I should do. And it's like, well, you know.
That's your job, man.
Yeah, that's part of being a GM. You gotta roll with it at some point.
Yeah. No, I mean, I'm the same. I've been like DMing and role playing for years, but I've only recently started into the sort of publishing content, like, you know, the sort of more business side of it and like production side of it, because I felt like I wanted to start producing content. So I'm currently writing my own campaign to publish in the future, as well as doing some other projects that for like other companies that I'm doing now that obviously they're going to publish that. And it's, you do really have to. It does, again, it changes how you write. You know, when you write a campaign for your friends, there's, you know, you can do it kind of loosey-goosey and like, you know, there can be gaps. But when you're writing it for as a product, it's got to be lean, it's got to be tight, it's got to be well-formatted. And there's all those other elements that add work to it that you don't really consider. Like the campaign I'm running for my colleagues at the moment is also the campaign that I'm going to publish. I'm using them as kind of my test players.
Cool.
And writing it at the same time as playing it is difficult because I'm writing it in this format ready to be published. But then when I'm running it, I just want notes. And like, I don't, you know, it's almost like I'm reading someone else's source book, but it's a source book I've written.
Yeah.
So it's difficult. I'm having to prepare for my sessions way earlier than normal because I'm structuring it in this particular way because I'm making an actual product.
Yeah. Yeah. I did something similar with mine. I'd kind of written it ahead of time. And then I started running it for a group. And while I was running it, I was kind of revising it.
Yeah.
And then when I was done, I went back through the adventure again. And I found a big thing I had to do was try to remember all the things I did while I was running it, just kind of on the fly, like ideas I came up with. Oh, I'll do this. And make sure that they were all in there, like written. Because there was a lot of stuff that I came up with while I was running it that really, I think, improved the adventure, but it wasn't written in what I had. I had to add it in later.
Yeah. Yeah. Notepads are your friend. Yeah. I take notes constantly while playing.
Yeah. So what games are you playing right now or what game?
So I'm running a fifth edition campaign for my group at work. I'm currently dabbling in So I've got a Dark Heresy campaign that I co-wrote and co-ran with a group of friends when I lived in Poland that I'm currently revising and planning to redo.
Awesome.
And I'm also, this is kind of more on the side, but I'm sort of just starting to get the fleshing out a Call of Cthulhu campaign because I got the new edition, the new hardback edition books before I left for Canada. And I love them, and I love the direction they've taken with the new stuff. So I really want to do a group for that because I always find that like there's a certain group of role players that are very like the combat or anything, and the exploring isn't the focus. It's the investigation and the talking and the role play.
Yeah.
So I really want to write a campaign that's like that because the current group I've got, they love the adventuring, combat, fighting monsters, getting the treasure. But I've got another group of friends who want to do role play, but they don't want to do that kind of role play.
Okay.
So I'm trying to write a campaign for like a smaller group, which, you know, I see it more as like, you know, the current like fifth edition campaign I'm doing now, we like gather after work, we have like, you know, drinks and snacks and we, you know, it's quite like casual.
Yeah.
Whereas the Call of Cthulhu one, it's probably going to be more of a once every month around someone's house with like ambient lighting and like whiskey.
Yeah, know? Nice.
Like that kind of tonal difference. So that's probably not going to happen for a while just because I've got a lot of other projects going on, but that's kind of, I'd like to play that soon.
Well, as these things come out, definitely let me know and I can let people know on the show to check out your adventures and whatnot.
Yeah, I mean, the most recent one, the one that will be first down, is I'm writing one of the source books for Open Legend RPG.
Okay.
The Kickstarter that happened recently. So I'm doing their Norse mythology influenced source book, The Shores of Valhalla.
Cool. That sounds cool.
So I'm currently one of the writers on that, which is super cool. I'm super digging it, and it's shaping up really nicely, and I'm excited for that. And that's sort of my current main project in the RPG space.
You know, I have never actually played any of the versions of Call of Cthulhu.
Really?
Yeah, it's one of those games I've always wanted to play. I've always wanted to run. I just never have. So would you recommend this newest version for a Cthulhu virgin to cut their teeth on, or one of the older ones?
I think this version is really good. I mean, they haven't changed a great deal. It's not had the sweeping like changes that like Dungeons and Dragons has had in its previous editions.
Okay.
It's very much still stuck to the formula because again, it's very RPG focused. It's very role playing centric, but I love it. I think it's one of my favorite systems. But what I would say for like a Call of Cthulhu virgin is, getting one of the, because the books are like, there's only two books. It's like the player's handbook and then like the DM's guide, and that's pretty much it. And then I would like maybe invest in getting one of the pre-done adventures from either Chaosium or like someone else, and playing through that to get a new DM and a new group into it, because it's quite a different style of role play.
Okay.
And I think having a pre-done adventure or a pre-done storyline would help with that sort of learning curve.
Yeah.
I just backed one. Let me just nip to Kickstarter. I just backed one recently, actually, because I saw it and I thought that sounds cool and it's different to how I... Because I write in a very linear fashion. I like writing stories which are like linear.
Uh-huh.
And I backed this RPG, Call of Cthulhu RPG module called The Star on the Shore,
okay,
which is basically like it's like a sandbox.
Cool.
So they've done this like sandbox where you go to this town. It's set in 1920s New England, and it's easy to talk to and loads of things to investigate, but it's very loosely structured so that you can like the player characters can go and talk to any character at any time and follow the different arcs, and it's much more sandboxy because I've never done a campaign like that. So I was like, I'm going to get that and I'm going to use it to like sort of introduce myself to the sandbox style of thingy, because I'd quite like to, you know, I'd quite like to write something in like my own setting. If I was going to do it, it'd be cool to do a sandbox where you can just explore the world building a bit more.
Yeah, I'm looking at the Kickstarter now. Oh my god, that thing went gangbuster.
Yeah,
$4,000 goal, and they hit over 34,000. That's awesome.
It looks cool. Awesome. Like, I'm super excited, and the fact that like I get a print version, I love like. I like having things in my hand. Like I just like having printed off stuff. So yeah, I'm super excited to get that.
Cool.
And give that a whirl.
Yeah, it's kind of funny. I can almost kind of order my life based on what games I was playing and running. Like for me, when I was in college, it was a lot of Vampire the Masquerade.
Yep.
And Changeling the Dreaming. And when I was in high school, it was a lot of West End game Star Wars and D&D Second Edition.
Oh man, it's like we're on the same path. Like that's the same for me. Like high school was like D&D and Star Wars, and then like university was like I did World of Darkness.
Yeah.
And then more D&D, and then Call of Cthulhu, and then it's weird. Like I guess as you mature, and then you get hungry for more mature kind of RPGs. So it's like World of Darkness, Call of Cthulhu comes in. And then you get bored of that and think, oh, I just want to smash things with swords and dragons and shit. And then, I can see the trend. Although I've always played Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay. That's always been my go-to game, like with my friends. Cause obviously my first like roleplay group, we all played like Warhammer and 40K, so Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay was like a nice sidebar to what we liked, because we knew we liked the Warhammer world. So it was like, and we've always played that. We still play it to this day. Like every, I mean, we're all spread out doing other shit now, but like when we'll try and get together like once a year or once every 2 years and have a weekend of Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay, just because it's what we've always gone back to.
Cool. I've never played that, but I got reading about it, and actually I've stolen some ideas from it for my homebrew world.
Yeah.
So I'm like, oh, this will work great.
I think what I used to like about it is we did like random races and random classes, because there's so many like jobs in that game. So It was like we did like random roles, so we never knew what we were going to play or who we were going to be. So we just had the most ridiculous parties ever, just crazy characters. But classes in that game, well, they weren't classes, they were just like, it was like your profession. But they ranged from everything to like mages and professional soldiers to like cooks and beggars and everything in between. So you could literally be anything. You could be literally useless in a fight.
That's hilarious.
Yeah, it was good. It was fun. I do like it.
Yeah, I just started running Curse of Strahd again. Hopefully we're going to finish this time. So I might have to wait till I finish that before I get into Cthulhu. That might be a little bit too much darkness all at once.
Yeah. I can see that. Yeah. I've not run Curse of Strahd yet. I've used it to influence my homebrew campaign.
Uh-huh.
But I haven't just run that book, but I've got it and I really want to, because the book is a brilliant, brilliant book. Like such a step up. And like the one Storm of Giants as well.
Yeah.
Really, really good. Like I really want to run them, because I think they're so well done.
Yeah, I think you could keep yourself busy for quite a while just running all the published stuff for 5th edition. Yeah. You'd never finish. Totally. They release them faster than you can run them.
Yeah. Yeah, man, the quality bar just keeps going up and up with those books. Like I think them bringing them internal was what was probably the deciding factor. I think that was such a smart move for them, because I feel like reading, because I owned one of the earlier ones, and then flicking through the new ones and then going back, like there is such a difference. And not that the old ones are bad in any respect, really. Like as source books, I think they're pretty good.
Yeah.
But I don't know what it is, but the new ones, like just the consistency and the quality level is just really, really high.
Yeah.
I think when you're producing like a full color hardback product like that and you're charging a premium price, I think it's really important to have that.
Yeah. Yeah. I've been really happy with them. I'm excited to do Curse of Strahd. I ran a campaign online. We got maybe, I don't know, somewhere between a third and a halfway through it before the group kind of fell apart. And I was really bummed, because it's such a good campaign. But
yeah,
I've got a home group going now, and we started it. So I'm excited.
That's good. Yeah, I haven't done any like online role playing yet. It's something that I keep thinking about. I want to try, because I have so many friends now who aren't local to me, because I moved to the back end of nowhere.
Yeah.
Well, as far as American cities go, I guess. So it's like I keep dabbling with the concept of running an online thing, because I've watched, you know, like I watched the D&D Dice Camera Action.
Uh-huh.
Chris Perkins runs that, I think, is really good. And, you know, I watched some of the Encounter Roleplay stuff, and there's loads of groups online, and like the one that Matt Mercer did for Geek and Sundry, The Fourth Grey. You could literally just fill all of your time with watching and doing RPG content at this point. It's so, I love how, not mainstream, but how popular it's become, and how, you know, it's really blossomed in the last sort of few years.
Yeah. Yeah. I remember when it was kind of social suicide to admit you played RPGs, and it's definitely not like that anymore.
No. Thanks, Stranger Things.
Yeah. Yeah. Totally. That in Community.
Yeah. Oh, man. That is easily one of my favorite episodes of anything of all time. That D&D episode is perfect.
Yeah, it was so great.
It nails it. It nails it so well. Oh, that's another one, Harmon Quest. I love watching Harmon Quest.
That one I haven't heard of. I have to check that out.
So it's Dan Harmon who wrote Community.
Oh, okay.
And he's got like a stand-up show, but he's got like a comedy show that he's already done, like a podcast. And then he's done this Harmon Quest, which is like him and his like celebrity friends playing D&D, and they have like a guest star on every week, And Spencer Gilbert runs, he wrote the campaign and runs it for them. He was also he's a comic genius. like his timing is the best DM ever. His timing is so good. And yeah, they've run it and they like did it as a show on CISO, and it's done, they've got like an animated, so when you're watching it, it flicks between looking at them, playing it around the table, and then flicking to the animated version of it. And it's so good. It's one of my favorite like D&D-esque sort of online campaigns. I think it's actually Pathfinder is the system.
Okay.
But yeah, it's super funny. It's really, really funny.
Cool. I found their website. I have to check that out. Very cool.
Yeah, give that a watch. It's if you haven't seen it before, it's pretty good. I love the comedy side. I mean, I like watching actual groups play actual D&D and like seeing them go through the campaign like more what Matt Mercer does. But then I also love the more comedy focused, shenanigans based stuff that's like, you know, that's just funny to watch.
Yeah. Yeah, I have to confess, I really have a hard time getting into stuff like the actual play. Like, for instance, Critical Role is a perfect example. Like, I'm loving it until they get into a combat. And then it's just like, yeah. I wish that they would later, like, go back and have all the people come back and say, okay, we're going to watch the combat and then we're going to basically just role play it and not do any of the die rolling, you know, and make it more like the rest of the show is. But no one's done that yet. That would probably take a lot of time.
No, it is. I totally get where you're coming from as well. Like, it's hard to watch people roll dice for combat and do all that jazz.
Yeah.
I think Force Grey, I think it's a production value thing. I think that's where it is. Like Force Grey, that Matt Mercer did, I think that was the only one that's done it really well, because they had lots of cameras and they had like a board with minis on that they didn't really focus on, but it was there as reference, and the combats weren't very long.
Uh-huh.
And yeah, they did try to make it a bit more interesting, like what they were doing. They weren't just saying like, oh, I'll attack that guy. It was like there was a bit more to it. I think that's the only show where it's not bugged me.
Well, it's probably edited too, right? Because Critical Role, I don't think is edited. So you could do a lot just editing out like the long pauses while someone's looking something up and stuff like that.
Yeah, no, yeah, that's definitely a factor. Yeah, the editing. But yeah, it seems to be the way to get around it. Yeah, I don't know how you fix live RPG sessions, like live play. That's,
yeah.
I hope someone figures it out soon, but I don't know.
Yeah, I think someone will eventually. I think there's a way to do it. And, you know, it just would take a level of production and commitment maybe that we haven't seen yet. Someone with the money and the time to do it.
This is Shane from the Total Party Thrill podcast, and you're listening to Lex Starwalker on Game Master's Journey.
I want to give a quick shout out to the patrons of Starwalker Studios. The support of the patrons makes this show possible. If you enjoy Game Master's Journey and you'd like to give a little back, becoming a patron is a great way to do so. Patrons get some cool perks like game material I make for Primordia and access to a special monthly podcast I produce just for the patrons. I'd also like to give a huge shout out and thank you to my tier 4 patron, Mr. Steve Strickland. Let's hear it for Steve. Thank you so much, Steve, and thank you to all the patrons. You can find out more about becoming a patron by clicking on the Patreon button at the top of the show notes at starwalkerstudios.com.
Okay, so I'm still crawling my way through the backlog of episodes because, man, there are a lot.
Yeah.
Like
140 some.
Yeah. I started at episode 100 because I listened to the 100 episode because it was like, you know, you basically summed up all of your past and what you'd done. And I really liked it. I liked all the feedback you were getting and listening to like how you were thinking about the structure and running and doing the podcast. I thought it was really interesting. And it felt like a logical place to start. I don't know why. And then I started from there and I really liked the cleric two-parter that you did.
Oh, cool.
And how you talked about the use of gods. And I was like, yes, this makes so much sense. like breaking down, like, so magic wasn't this like divine and arcane thing. It was like all part of the same pool. That's what everyone drew from and how everyone would. I think the thing you nailed, which I was like, yes, preach it. This is a good thing. was the whole everyone having their own healing mechanics and breaking that tank healer DPS structure that has just permeated gaming for what feels like forever.
Yeah.
I think the way you tackled that and how mages would have like a healing spell and stuff like that was really, really good. Like, I really enjoyed that. And I thought it was really like clever, like a way around it.
Yeah, that's something I still try to figure out. Is like, you know, because my question is, you know, if everybody could have healing magic, then what is the cleric then? You know, I guess they're a spellcaster that wears armor. I don't know. Like,
yeah, I guess it makes them. I've always seen clerics as a frontline support character where they can get stuck into the fight and they can take a beating and they can dish out a beating, but they also provide the group with utility and provide benefits and help everyone by being there rather than being this healing dispenser.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I always think, an example of a cleric in its purest form would be a warrior priest from Warhammer.
Okay.
Like, they were the priests of Sigmar, who was like the human god, but they were like dudes in like chainmail armor carrying massive hammers, and they would be at the front line, they would wade into combat preaching like Sigmar's name, and they would be casting holy spells to protect themselves and their like soldiers, but they'd also be casting like smiting magic on enemies. And it's like, that is a cleric.
Yeah.
Someone who uses their belief and the power of their belief as a weapon and as a shield against threats, but in a very like physical way and in a very like facing the threats head on.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. That's cool. I've been reading the Wheel of Time books again, and I really like how in that series, it's kind of the idea that I was trying to get to is there is just one source of magic, but it's just like each person kind of has what they're good at. So you might have a particular character that they're really good at healing, you know, and you might have another character that they can only heal a little bit or they can't heal at all, but it's all like it's not like they're different classes. Like they'd all be the same class. It's just like almost like the schools of magic. Like what are you, like where do you have special ability and where do you have no ability and just a little, but
yeah.
It seems like to make that work, you'd almost have to just redo the game from the ground up.
I mean, yeah, to make a change like that, you would have to adjust it from the ground up. But yeah, I think that's a really a cool way of looking at it, like how magic is this force and how you use it is based on your own personal ability to use it.
Yeah.
I think that's a really elegant system that allows you a great range of flexibility in how it's portrayed and how it's wielded by the heroes in the world.
Yeah.
That's a really cool idea.
Just don't know how to do it.
I think that's as good a starting point as any, really.
Yeah. Yeah. I also like the idea of, I don't know, I guess one of my things is I kind of have issues with the whole class aspect of the game. Like I'd love to get away from classes altogether.
Yeah.
Because, you know, in more of a like, I'm going to learn this ability, like I'm going to learn to use a sword or I'm going to learn to cast healing spells and be able to do that instead of saying I am a fighter, so I can do these things and I can't do those things, which...
Yeah, I mean the Elder Scrolls video games.
Yeah,
they've always done that. You know, you are good at what you do, and whatever you want to do is what you'll be good at. Yeah. And there is no real class. And it's like, I think I can totally see games like D&D. I think they'll always have classes because I think it's so associated with the game.
Right.
Yeah. It's like one of its like staple pillars. You know, but I think you might see. I think you've started to see it already. Like when I look through the classes now. And like they have their subtypes and they have like their different archetypes and each class has these things. It's like you can start to see it forming where you're getting a bit more choice over what you want to do.
Right.
It's still quite rigid, but I feel like it's going to be an iterative thing. And maybe in like the next edition, whenever that happens, you might see something like you have three broad categories, which is like brawler, rogue, and spellcaster.
Yeah.
And then within that, you have, okay, well, what kind of spellcaster are you? Are you a necromancer? Are you a sorcerer? Are you a pyromancer? You know, they'll have all these different ways to keep refining your choice, but you'll be under much broader umbrellas. But I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah. I think they're kind of experimenting with that in some of the Unearthed Arcana stuff. Because I remember they did one for Rogue, and they had, I think it was called the Scout. It was a new archetype for the Rogue. And I'm like, this seems like it should be a Ranger, you know?
Yeah.
But it's like, well, maybe they're like, well, if you're a Rogue, but you kind of want to be a Ranger, then you can do this.
I think you're right. I think they are experimenting on it. And I could even see, this is really out there, but I could totally see a system where you get given like almost points to spend, and then you spend them on gaining skills, spells, proficiencies, talents, and stats.
Yeah.
And then basically you pick your race and you pick like a, your career, you know, like the sort of more narrative background of your character.
Yeah.
And then you basically, all of the like combat and game mechanic stuff, you pick by just spending points. Like everyone has a pool of 100, and, you know, weapon proficiencies cost you 10, abilities and spells might cost you different amounts, like 15, 20, whatever. And then you basically build your character starting point from the things that you want to do. So it's like, I want to be a spellcaster, but I want to wield a crossbow. And my whole thing is going to be, I'm going to infuse my crossbow bolts with magic, and I'm going to be like this weird gunslinger crossbow person who the magic is infused into my crossbow bolts, and that's how I cast my spells.
Yeah.
And then you can do it because you just spend the points on weapon proficiencies and spells, and then you make the rest up as you go, and it's your character, and then you feel like you have your own character with your own story, but you're still constrained within the rules of the game.
Yeah.
So it's not going to break anything by doing it.
Yeah, it's a lot like how Vampire and Changeling worked, you know. It's just, what do you want? Just pay the points.
Exactly, yeah.
And then as you quote, level up, it's the same kind of thing. Like, oh, you get more points to buy stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It could be kind of like in video games, how you have like your talent trees. So it's like, oh, you learned Firebolt. Well, now you can learn Fireball. And you learn Fireball. Yeah. Now you can learn Meteor Swarm, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah. No, for sure. And they I could see them maybe keeping them with loose archetypes. So if you wanted to, because I think they're all about player choice, it seems like. When you read the books, it's all about, you know, hey, you do what you want to do.
Right.
You know, here's feats. You don't have to use them, but here they are. I feel like maybe they'll keep going that way and be like, here's some class archetypes that you can use, and they're preset with all your points spent, so you don't have to think about it. So if you know you really want to play a traditional rogue, or you want to play a traditional mage, you can do that straight out of the book. You can just go, right, I'm going to take these things here and I'm a mage.
Yeah.
And then you're done. And then people who want to have those classes can still have them. And it's not gonna change the game for them.
Right.
And I think they'll always try and keep that option available for players because it's so tied to what D&D fundamentally is as a game.
Yeah.
But I can see them opening the system up. So because I feel like they're getting really close to having a really solid core rule set. And I think once they feel like they've nailed that, I think then they'll start to open it up for people to use. Because I mean, there's nothing stopping you doing that right now.
Right, right.
Like you could go through the player's handbook and allocate points to everything and go, right, if you want to build your character, there you go.
Yeah. Yeah. And you've got enough examples with all the classes and subclasses to kind of work out what everything would cost, you know, because they're already supposedly balanced among themselves. So there you go.
Yeah. And you could keep certain things apart. So you could say like, no, you can't be an invisible pyromancer mage who can stay invisible and then cast the stupid mega spells because that will be broken. It's like, you have to stick to a like narrative theme for your character. So you can't just take the best, you can't dual wield two-handed weapons, cast fireball and go invisible, you know? Yeah.
And cast resurrect and wish.
Yeah, exactly. You can't just take everything. You know, you would cost it accordingly and like put some restrictions on it. But, you know, I feel like Wizards have a team of game developers and game designers that they're probably the best people to do this rather than like some dedicated person in the community who really wants to tackle that particular thing.
Yeah, yeah, totally.
It'd be nice to see them do what, like, I really like how they've done feats this time around, where it's like you can have a stat increase or you can have a feat, and you can like, there's that flexibility, and it gives you, I think giving players more choice in RPGs is always good. Giving them the choice to define their character and make it feel unique to them is always a good thing.
Yeah. And another great thing about that is like my group right now, I have one player who's pretty comfortable with the rule set. So when they get the fourth level, I'd be like, hey, you could take a feat if you want to. And then I have another couple players that are completely new to the hobby and, you know, So for them, I would be like, hey, you should just take a stat increase, and this is probably the best one for you, you know? So it's kind of nice. You can kind of manage how complicated your character is.
Yeah, totally.
Based on where you're at, you know?
I mean, they even do it in the player's handbook. They even do it for the classes. They have at the beginning, like, if you just want to take what we think is a good build for this class,
yeah,
take these things. Yeah. So you don't have to go for everything like, oh, I've got like 10 choices to make now. It's like, oh my God, what do I take? You can just go, you know, oh, this says you can. And like you say, with new players, I was doing that with, because the guys I'm running for, they haven't really played D&D, most of them. So they were like, I was like, oh, you can take this skill or you can have this skill. And they were like, I don't know. And it's like, oh, you've got 3 spells to pick. Like, what spells do you want? And they'd be like, oh, there's like 30 options. I'd be like, yeah, okay. Well, this says that like some good choices are this, this, and this. And then they're like, oh yeah, okay, well, I'll take those then. You know, so it does, there is definitely a place for template stuff like that to exist alongside a system that allows you to completely pick what you want.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. One thing that I did with my first campaign I did in fifth edition was an idea I got from actually the Adventures League organized play, where they have a rule where until you're fourth level, you can actually change things. Like you can change what spells you picked or change what skills you picked or even change what class you are and kind of rebuild your character. So since I was new to the game and everybody playing was new to the game, I'm like, hey guys, until fourth level, you can basically change anything that you want if you decide, oh, this spell sucks, or oh, I really don't like being a fighter, you know.
That's really cool.
So it's kind of hard to make that make sense, like, story-wise sometimes, but...
No, but I do like that. I didn't know about that. That's really cool. I think that's really useful because, yeah, a lot of stuff, I think... We have found that, actually. I've had players where they've taken, like, a thing or, like, a skill, and they've taken it thinking it's one thing. And then when you actually get into the game and they use it and they try and use it, and they're like, oh, I didn't realize it did that. Oh, I didn't realize it worked that way. Yeah. That sucks.
I don't want this. Look, no.
Yeah, that's really cool. Yeah, giving them like a mulligan essentially on the stuff they pick early is a good idea.
You know, something you mentioned, it got me thinking. You know, we kind of have, like, it depends what class you pick, but where you don't really get all your class abilities until like second or third level when you pick like your archetype. So like if you're a mage, you pick your school or whatever. I could almost see it, you know, in the next edition, it being like what you're saying, where at first level, you just decide, do I want to be a brawler or a spellcaster? You know, and it's not until like third level that you decide, okay, I'm going to be a cleric, or I'm going to be a wizard, or I'm going to be a ranger. So for new players, you know, you just make this very general, do you want to use weapons or do you want to use magic? Or do you want to be something in between? And that's all you have to worry about at first level. And then you get to play for a bit before you decide more specific what you want to be. I could see something like that happening.
Yeah, I think that's a really nice way of, especially for new players, I think having that kind of system would be really beneficial. Yeah, definitely. Because all you'd have to do really is, like, I think you could break all the classes down into the three main categories of like frontline fighter, support, sideline fighter, like rogues and rangers, and then you've got your spellcasters. And I think you pick like a loose thing. Do you want to be in the middle of the fighting, in the thick of it, getting battered? Do you want to be sneaking around, firing arrows and stabbing people when the opportunity presents itself? Or do you want to be hurling spells and like, you know, doing all that shit? And it's like, you pick that, and then you'd have like a little template that gave you a little taste of all of those elements that make up those classes. And then when you get to like fourth level or whatever, like you say, you then go, okay, what did you really like about this class? Did you like having a shield and having heavy armor and wading in and taking the hits for the team? Or did you like wielding a big sword and like cutting things in half while you whirlwind around and letting them sort of learn through experience what kind of playstyle they preferred? I think that would definitely be an interesting way to, because I think they're really concerned with introducing new players to the game. I think that's a massive, like, that's a big drive through, I think, the format of a lot of new products. And I think something like that, like if you added like an additional book to the starter set with the Lost Mines of Phandelver, like a little pamphlet that's like, okay, tell your players that they can have one of these three archetypes and this will be on their character sheet, and then talk you through the steps of helping them specialize. I think if that was also in there to help those characters evolve and grow, I think that'd be really cool. I think I could see that being very popular.
Yeah, I agree. Like for new players, I've realized recently, like last year or so, that the way to go is have them use a pre-gen at first, because you know, making a character is kind of hard if you haven't ever played the game before. But I think another weakness of it for new players is that at the very beginning you pick a class, and I mean you can multi-class, but you're still kind of stuck with that decision forever. And if you're brand new, you don't know necessarily what class you want to play. So being able to kind of try, like, test out things before you have to really say, okay, this is what I'm doing forever.
Yeah.
Would be really nice.
It is. It's difficult. And I, like, there's loads of, I mean, I wrote an article recently about how I like to prepare for running a long campaign. And one of the key things is, like, I don't have a session zero where I do character creation en masse as, like, the first session. I did it with each player individually before we started playing, like, a good 2 weeks before. And I sat down with each one and explained, like, what they would get, like, what the class meant, like, what things they could expect, like, how it was going to sort of play out, what kind of themes they had, and sort of started to build their backstory for me. Because for me, character creation is not about the stats or what class you are. It's about the character you are.
Right.
And
right.
How you're going to role play and what themes you want. So it's like I would sit down with them and help them start to define that. And, you know, and it really did help. Like, you know, they really got into their character and their past and like what their personal goals were going to be. And I think it's really important to do that. But what I also did, which I don't think I actually mentioned in my article, but now I think about it, like, 2 months before the campaign, so like sort of near Christmas, I ran a one-shot with the people who are interested in playing D&D, where they used pre-gens and they picked classes, and then I took them through this adventure, and it was like Christmas-themed, and they were rescuing Santa from Krampus, and it was all, you know, it was very lighthearted and fun, but it introduced them to D&D and the concept of combat and role-playing. And the interesting thing is that when we went into character creation then, like, some people, they wanted to play a class like the one they played in the thingy, mm-hmm. in the standalone. They wanted to play a similar class. And one of them actually created, I think, the daughter or descendant of their character from the one-shot. So we assumed the one-shot happened in the past.
Oh, cool.
And this character was related to their original character because they really liked how they played. Whereas other people, they were like, I didn't like how that played. I'm going to try something different.
Yeah.
So it was this good mix, because I think that also is like, it's the similar thing of introducing people in an environment where it's like, this is not your permanent character, this is not what you're going to play for the next X number of weeks or whatever, so just pick one at random and see which one you think you liked. And then it gives them that taste, and then I think then they know if they liked it or not, which I think, you know, if we didn't have the ideal system that we're talking about, I think that's a good way of sort of easing players into character creation and picking a class that they're hopefully going to enjoy.
Yeah, that'd be cool. You could even start out, like, first session, everybody plays pre-gens. And then second session, it's like, well, if you know what you want to do, you can make a character at this point. Or you can play the same pre-gen, or you can play a different pre-gen to try something out. And just wait until everybody's finally, like, I know what I want to play now, and then say, okay, now you're all second level.
You're all level one until everyone agrees that they like what they're playing.
Yeah, and until then, every week it's different characters or whatever.
I mean, like, that is one way of doing it. I think that would be quite fun, and you would definitely ensure it might help keep groups together maybe and keep people interested.
Yeah.
But like for me, when like, because I had a campaign that I was telling a story and I wanted to have them play through that story, like I wanted to get into it as soon as I could.
Right.
And so having everyone change characters and all this stuff like weeks for several weeks at a time would have delayed that.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's not a bad idea. I quite like that.
But, you know, I have had where I start a campaign and we play for a few sessions or maybe even a few levels. And I have a player come to me and say, you know, I'm really not digging my character. Can I make a new character? And I'm usually like, well, yeah, of course you can. But I'd rather like get that over with at the beginning before we're like 2 months into the story. And suddenly someone's like, you know, I don't really like playing a bard. I want to play something else. It's like, well, we build up all this backstory for your character and I have all these things planned for this character. And now, like, you don't want to play this character anymore. It's kind of a drag.
Yeah. Especially if people have been like role playing their characters and stuff like that.
Yeah.
It can be disruptive. But I think I'd handle that by just having them be killed off in an exciting way and then having their new character be introduced to the party afterwards.
Yeah.
So that their character gets, you know, I mean, that's also a thing I've considered doing. I haven't tried it yet, but having everyone play pre-gens for the first session until everyone kind of knows what they want to play. And then they create their actual characters. And then they have like a boss fight with the pre-gens, like as the introduction for their characters into the campaign.
Oh, cool.
So it's like, you know, so like you would have this resolution of like, they're killing off their old characters. And these are their actual characters, but I didn't just want to have it where, you know, you want to keep that world. So it's like, well, yeah, your characters do exist now, but that bunch of characters you were playing last week on that mission that you did, well, now you have to, like, you're now against them and you have to go and deal with them because they're now causing a problem. So you have to go and kill your own characters off. I think that could be a funny way of doing things, but I haven't tried it yet.
Yeah. Yeah. And there are, you know, there are different games that handle things different ways. And I think Shadow of the Demon Lord has something sort of similar to some of what we've been talking about, where you start out with a character class, but you have opportunities as you go on to like specialize one way or another.
Yeah.
And Numenera, which is another game I played quite a bit, they basically had three classes. You had basically your fighter, your spellcaster, and then a character that was kind of like a hybrid of fighter and spellcaster.
Yeah.
But then you had other aspects of your character, your focus that you picked that was completely separate than that and kind of gave you special abilities. But that one also, like, you picked everything at the very beginning and then that's kind of what you were, you know?
Yeah. So I'm pretty convinced that everything that we've spoken about has been done by someone already in some system somewhere that I just haven't played.
Right.
Like, I'm not even going to pretend that anything that we've suggested doesn't already exist. Like, we're some kind of prophets, like, oh, this would be a great thing. Yeah, of course it is. It already exists in four different systems, but...
But finding one that has everything you're looking for, that's the tricky part.
That's it. Bringing them all together to form one super system.
Yes. Unless you write your own, that's probably the only way that's going to happen. Yeah. Because everybody wants different things, you know?
Yeah, exactly. And everyone's got different play styles and everyone's got different ideas of what makes for a better experience or what makes for more interesting, like, mechanics. And no one's wrong. Like, I've not played a system that I've fundamentally hated ever.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, every system I've been like, I like this idea. I love that idea. I like that. You know, there's always things that I like about a system, but there's always things that I don't like about a system. Well, that's the nature of it.
And, you know, your group changes too, because, you know, we've been talking about new players, but if you're playing D&D and everybody's a veteran, then everybody knows exactly what they want to play at session one. Yeah. You don't need to worry about pre-gens because they're like, I want to be a necromancer wizard and I want these feats and I want these spells and I know exactly what I want. So,
which it poses completely different problems, because that's great from a getting started point of view because they all know what they're doing and they all know what they want. But it also poses problems from like a, you know, like a GM ad-libbing, because they probably know the rules as well and they probably call you out when you change things, and it's like you have less freedom to do that in a magical way. Whereas new players, they don't see when you tweak something and they don't see when you adjust something to help them or hinder them. Whereas experienced players, they're always going to see that. Like, when, if you change a monster's health, they're like, well, why has it got that health? It should have this health. Or why has it got that? It should have a dex of this and stuff like that. And it's like playing, GMing for like a veteran group poses just a whole different set of problems that are just equally as difficult to overcome, but are just different from a new player group.
Yeah. Yeah, I have to say, in general, I tend to prefer running for new players because you know, they don't know the rules. And I usually tell them, you know, don't worry about the rules. I'll worry about the rules. You just tell me what you want your character to do. And I've just found that a lot of times you get much better role playing from those people than the people that know the rules inside and out, and they're getting distracted by, you know, oh, well, if I use this feat and this spell together, you know, I can make this combination. And they're thinking of it more mechanically as a game and less as what would my character do or what is my character thinking right now?
Yeah, trying to min-max the systems.
Yeah.
That's annoying. just annoying, just straight up annoying. But I like that about new players too. And I like that they're not as familiar with like the worlds and stuff and things like that. And it's like there's a bit of that unknown for them, which I think is also exciting.
Yeah.
But I really like how new players, like say, they don't have to focus on the rules, and it allows you to direct them to like more role play and to be like to play their characters and get really into that, which I like doing, and I like that a lot. But I say to all my players, like, I don't know all the rules. I'm not a database. So it's like, I expect the players to like know at least what their class abilities do, so I don't have to remember like six different classes at once and like what their spells do. Because they're like, oh, I want to cast this. And I'm like, yep, I don't know what it does. Just tell me what it does so that I don't have to, you know. So, but that's it. I don't want them to like, they don't have to know. Like if they ask me every time how perception is generated, I'm fine telling them that and stuff. And I don't mind any of that. But I just say to them, look, if you can remember like what your abilities do, that would be great, because I don't want to have to try and remember everything.
Or print it out or mark it in your book so you can find it. Yep.
Those cute spell cards that they do, like get them.
Yeah.
And so you've got your spells. I love that. I love gaming aids, stuff like that.
Yeah.
As long as the players are willing to like get them themselves sort of thing. It's not, I'm like, I don't want to have to buy 9 decks of spell cards.
Yeah, right. Classes.
Like 5 of which are not even going to get used for a year because no one's playing those classes.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, I hear you. Yeah, I, you know, a lot of times, especially in the past, I was recruiting people for games that had never played before. So, you know, it's kind of like, you know, none of them had the book. none of them had anything. I was lucky if they all showed up with dice. So, yeah, that can be rough.
Yeah, it can. It can be tricky. Like I bought all my players a set of dice just because I saw it cheap on Amazon. Like it was like 6 sets of like role play dice that was like everyone you'd need, and it had each one had a little bag, and I was like, that's a cute little gift.
Yeah,
you know, I'd be like, oh hey, you know, this is your first time role playing, here's a cute little gift, it's a set of dice and that'll be useful for you. So I like that, you know. And you know, obviously I anticipated the whole they won't have dice,
yeah,
because you know, some of them did because some of them had played other games with other groups, but some of them had never played a role play game before and had no concept of what dice would be required. So it's just like, and it's a nice little, you know, makes it feel a bit special.
Yeah, that's cool. I want to thank Stephen so much for coming on the show and talking with us today. Really enjoyed our conversation. Lots of great stuff. I hope that you enjoyed this interview as much as I did. This is actually part 1 of a 2-part interview. So stay tuned for episode 149 next week to hear part 2 of the interview with Stephen. We've got more RPG related topics to talk about. So definitely let me know what you thought about our topics that we talked about today. And just in a minute, I'll tell you all the great and easy ways you can get a hold of me, but I'd love to hear from you. If you'd like to get a hold of Stephen, head to the show notes, starwalkerstudios.com. Check out the show notes for this episode, episode 148. I've got links to his blog and some of the projects he's working on. And a great way to keep up with Stephen and what he's doing is to follow him on Twitter at Rhodes_writes. That's at RHODES_WRITES. Or you can just head to the show notes at starwalkerstudios.com and I'll have his Twitter information there as well. And you can keep up with what he's doing. I want to send a shout out and a huge thank you to listener and friend of the show and active participant on the Game Master's Journey community, Dietrich Pfister. Hope I said your name right, sir. From the US, for his recent 5-star review on iTunes. The title of Dietrich's review is, If You Only Have Time for One RPG Podcast. Wow, that's high praise. Thank you, sir. He says, as a veteran of D&D and a DM of 25 years, I spent a lot of time perusing the internet to find a podcast for my relatively short work commute that was consistently engaging and got me thinking about the game in new ways. After several disappointing finds, I came upon Game Master's Journey and finally found something that fit the bill. As a homebrew setting writer, I have found a lot of inspiration in the world-building episodes as we followed the host Lex Starwalker as he walked through his own process. The recent episodes, breaking down the D&D 5th Edition Player's Handbook chapter by chapter, have been a wonderful refresher on the rules. So much so that I made my own PCs listen to a few of the episodes where some of the finer points of the combat and skill checks were deconstructed. That's awesome. You made your players listen. More listeners is always good. Greetings, Dietrix players. I hope you're still listening. In all, Lex's delivery is consistent and organized. The episode's well-produced and well-edited, and the content keeps a good pace with little filler. And the Google Plus community is a nice added bonus where you can talk with a lot of other GMs and Lex himself on the finer points of game mastering and game mastery. I'd recommend this podcast to game masters of all experience and skill levels, and definitely make your player characters listen to the Player's Handbook episodes. You'll thank Lex later for it. Thank you very much, Dietrich. That's a great, great review. And there are a few things in here that you said that I just want to comment on really quickly. First of all, you mentioned that you have limited time to listen to a D&D podcast. And I am really happy to hear that you find this show worth your time. I know recently, especially some of those Player's Handbook episodes have gotten really long, and I apologize for that. Thank goodness for the pause button. Am I right? But that means a lot to me because that's really important to me. And I try very hard to stay focused on this show. I listen to a lot of podcasts myself, and I listen to a lot of gaming podcasts myself. And I too know that it can be hard to find quality shows that don't waste your time. I don't have a lot of time to listen to podcasts. And in fact, these days, about the only time I have to listen to a podcast is when I'm in the shower. So I really look for shows myself that don't waste my time. And I've found a lot of shows, unfortunately, that I feel like they waste my time, whether it's because they're talking about things completely unrelated to the show, or they're just taking forever to get to the point, or whatever. You know, so I always try to learn from things I don't like in shows that I listen to. And I'm not going to bag any shows or anything like that. But I try to learn from other shows, things that they do well, things that I don't think they do well, and try to take those lessons to heart. And one thing I try very hard to do is to stay on topic, stay focused. I try very hard not to talk about things that aren't RPG related, or if I do, to at least make them relevant. You know, I think I do a pretty good job of that. It's especially challenging doing the show myself because I don't have anyone to corral me if I get on topic. But on the other hand, I think more often than not, having just me on the show is actually a boon when it comes to keeping the content focused. Because I've noticed with any podcast, the more voices you have on the show, the easier it is for things to go off on tangents and get derailed and everything like that. So every once in a blue moon, I'll get a question from someone that asks if I've ever considered having a co-host. And I think that, you know, doing the show Solamente really helps me stay on topic and stay focused and keeps things, you know, with as fine a laser focus as I can have. Also, you mentioned the world building episodes, and I'm glad that you enjoy those. And I know it's been a while since I've done a world building episode, but I am going to do more world building episodes. I'm not through with those. There will be more world building episodes in the future. Also, I'm glad that you like the Player's Handbook stuff. I'm going to very soon start a similar series with the Dungeon Master Guide, and I'm going to be digging into the Dungeon Master's Guide chapter by chapter. And I wanted to mention this on the show because a few things happened with the Player's Handbook. I started out, I wanted to do the Dungeon Master's Guide. I wasn't going to do the Player's Handbook at all. But then I decided to kind of breeze through it really quickly and hit the highlights for GMs just so that we could all be on the same page as far as the basic rules of the game. But as I started producing the episode, I just found more and more worthy of discussion and ended up spending a lot more episodes than I planned on the Player's Handbook and ended up just spending a lot more time. And I was trying to get through it as quickly as I could so I could get to the DMG, which is what I really wanted to talk about, because this is primarily a show for game masters, although, you know, it's for players too, but we really focus on the GM side of the screen. So the DMG was where I wanted to get. And because of that, I would just kind of stubbornly be like, I am doing this chapter in one episode. And I think there was one of the chapters I split up in two episodes. But for the most part, other than that one, I did them all one chapter per episode. And because of that, some of the episodes got crazy long. Like I had at least, I think, one or two that were over 2.5 hours long, which is just ridiculous. I mean, I try to keep this show to an hour. Even podcasts I really like, I start to lose steam on them after an hour. You know, I think more than an hour is just too long, personally. I'd rather produce 2-hour-long episodes than 1 2-hour episode. But so I just wanted to let people know, you know, 2-hour, 2.5-hour episodes, even 1.5-hour episodes are not going to be the norm. I'm trying to keep the episodes to around an hour. But I was just wanting to get through the Player's Handbook. So the DMG, it may take multiple episodes to get through a certain chapter because there's going to be a lot I want to talk about in there. There's going to be a lot I want to really drill down into, especially like the different variant rules you can use and pros and cons of those different variations. So I'm just going to have a different approach. We're going to take our time with the DMG. And so, you know, it may take 4 or 5 episodes to get through one chapter. I have no idea. But going to try to keep the episodes around an hour from now on. And I think most of the listeners will thank me for that. So again, thank you, Dietrich, for your review. I really appreciate it. And to all of you listening, leaving a review on iTunes is a great way that you can help out the show. It helps new listeners find the show, those who use iTunes. And if you leave a 5-star review, I'll even share your review on the show. So that is going to wrap it up for episode 148. If you would like to get a hold of me, please visit the website starwalkerstudios.com. There you can find all the different ways you can get a hold of me. You can email me. You can find my Twitter, Google+, Facebook, Pinterest, and YouTube information. You can also find the Game Master's Journey voicemail number if you would like to leave some audio feedback. And if your question or feedback is entertaining or enlightening or both, you may even hear your message on the show. So if you have any questions, feedback, or suggestions for future topics, I'd love to hear from you. Also, at starwalkerstudios.com, you can find a link to the Game Master's Journey community where you can share ideas with other listener GMs. And finally, you can learn about how you can support the show by becoming a patron, by making a one-time donation, or by using my Amazon referral link when you shop on Amazon. So you can find all this and more at starwalkerstudios.com. I hope that you have a chance to play your favorite RPG this week. I will be back soon with another episode of Game Master's Journey. Until then, game on.
This has been a Starwalker Studios production, your source for quality gaming and hobby podcasts.
This episode's music, courtesy of Cloudwalker, Transboy, Renfield, Stanko, and Ish. See the show notes for more details at starwalkerstudios.com/gamemastersjourney.